Good morning, Upland Church. It is officially fall, and I know some of you are so excited. And what's funny is in my house, they're not excited about fall. They like flip-flops, and it's not just, I hate flip-flops. I want covered, but my wife and my kids, they love flip-flops. And you may be a flip-flop person, or you may be the knee-high boot person. Or you may be in between and just want shoes. Or you just kind of like them all throughout the seasons. Now, the thing about that is that we all have different likes and dislikes. We all have different attitudes and things that appeal to us and some things that don't. For example, there's some of you who are wildly adamant, dedicated UT fans, right? Some of you are. There are. Okay, all eight of you here today. Then there's others that are diehard Virginia Tech fans. And then, all right, there's three. And then there's others of you that absolutely do not care. Amen. That right now, that raises the most of it. See, we all have these different things that appeal to us. And we all have these different things in life that stick out to us. And just as those things that stick out to us, it's the things that catches our attention. And if it catches our attention, then we're going to pause on it. We're going to focus on it. We're going to be able to dedicate some amount of time to it. Now, we may look at other people and we can't figure out why in the world they don't like football. Why in the world they don't like UT. And we'll argue like, what don't you like about it? They've got a dog. And then we're like, why don't you like a Hokie? It's a bird that nobody knows what it is, but it's cool. And then you're over here like, it's pigskin. Who cares? But we all have these different things that appeal to us, and these different things that attract our attention. And as they attract our attention, we're going to give some point of our life to it. And as we go through life, we're going to find things that are worth our attention and things that are not worth our attention. Things that appeal to us and things that are not. For example, whenever you find that perfect someone that appeals to you, oh man, they've got your full devoted attention. You're wondering how in the world you got so lucky that everybody else may have not pursued, but man, you pursued and you gained, and it's like, God, what did I do to deserve this woman? And you're like, you guys missed out. I am hooked up for life. And it gains our attention. But what happens when 1 year turns into 3 years? That turns into 5 years, that turns into 10 years, 18 years, 50 years. Does that still have your undivided attention? Maybe it's not about a relationship. Maybe it's about a job. You got a job, and it's the job that you wanted for so long, and there it is, and you've got it, and it's great. Things are going well. You know, you're putting food on the table. You're paying all the bills. Everything is good. But then you're there at year one. You're like, oh, okay. But year five, it's like, Year 10 is like, man, I do not want to go. See, I think there's a time in our life that these things that we give so much attention to that we can almost get to a point to where we can get complacent. To where it's just, it's ordinary. It's okay. See, the danger of this, especially with church, we can become so complacent with church that, hey, we come, we may sing a few songs, we're going to hear, you know, Tony or this morning Dad, you know, get up and stand up and say a few words. We're going to see somebody in a parking lot. Our kids are going to learn something. And we're just going to walk out different or the same instead of different every time. We fall into a rut. We become complacent. The next thing we know, every week matches the previous week. Work, come home, eat, straighten up, go to bed. Work, go home. I mean, the same thing every single time. Where's the wow factor? Where is the wow? Where's the wow? Where's the wow? I remember whenever my first child was born and we had to have an emergency C-section, and it really wasn't so sweet because they told me to get out of the way, but they did let me carry her from the operating room down the hallway all the way down and around to the birthing place where they kept them. And I mean, it was awesome. I mean, tears. Just, I don't even know why I was crying. It was just awesome. I was holding this 6-pound lump of love, and it was fantastic. And then we got to take her home, and it was still fantastic. And now she's been here with us for 14 years. And when I have this 14-year-old that still comes and just wraps her arms around me and says, "I love you, Daddy," I'm like, man, that's still wow. If we're not careful, we'll let the diapers and bills and, man, we're out of formula again. Like, child, stop. And we'll let these things just become a mundane routine. And we get complacent. We can get complacent as parents. We can become complacent as spouses. We can become complacent at our jobs. We can become complacent at schools, on our teams. We get this point of complacency where there's no wow factor anymore. No wow factor. Do you remember how it was whenever you first met that special someone and you could not wait to talk to them on the phone? Now, when they call, you're like, God, what do they want now? Why don't they just text? Just really, just text me. They could ask me that. Hey, will you pick up a jug of milk? That was a simple text. But now I got to answer. Yeah, how are you? Yeah, I'm good. Same thing every time. Yeah, what are you doing? I'm working. What are you doing? Oh, nothing. Did you need something? Oh yeah, can you pick up a jug of milk on your way home? You're like, come on, text it, right? Just send me a text. Where's the wow? Where's the wow? And this is where we can find ourselves in a dangerous place in anything we have in life, whether it be church, our relationship with God, family, marriage. Where's the wow? Where's the wow? It's because we have gotten so used to it always being there that it doesn't mean anything anymore. See, for us growing up, it was a very special treat for us whenever we got to eat out. We usually got to eat out once a month. I know I've shared this with you before. We got once a month. We left the farm in Nicholsville once a month, and we went to Walmart, and right beside Walmart on Stonegate was Little Caesars. So on our way in, Dad would go in and order us some pizza, and then we'd go into Walmart and we'd get supplies for a month. We wasn't going to be back to Walmart for 1 month. It didn't matter. 1 month. 1 month. That was it. I'm stressing the 1 month here because many of us go to Walmart several times a week, or your grocery store or Target, where once a month. And then we would leave, and we thought it was the grandest thing ever. We would go to the car, we'd be unloading groceries, and Dad would come out carrying this great, humongous, big rectangle pizza like this, and we'd eat pizza in the car. And we thought it was the most awesome thing ever. It was a very special treat, and we did it once a month. It wasn't very often that we did that. So it was a very special treat, but if we had that every single day, we would have become complacent. It would have been complacent. See, I think there's a danger that there's a very danger that we have, that we can become so used to something, and always expect it that it doesn't mean anything anymore. Like, what do you mean you get to wake up to your family kids? What do you mean you get to go to your job, you know, again this Monday morning? What do you mean you get to wake up to the same person? Have you smelled their breath? It's like a dragon. And you're like, I'm speaking to myself on that, not anybody else's. I smell like dragon breath because my kids do. They tell me. Church, where's the wow? Now, we look in the Bible, see these amazing stories of God about how, you know, Jesus walked in water, God raised the dead to life, and all these amazing miracles. But what about the miracle in us? Take a deep breath in right now. Just that was a gift from God. And it's become so routine to us, we're just complacent. We just expect that we're always going to have air there. We just always expect that it's going to be there. What happens when it's not? See, I think there's a danger in this. Look at me. This is the last verse that we read last week. This is Judges 15. And it's talking about Samson. And it says, this is Judges 15, verse 20, the last verse in this chapter. And it says, "And he judged Israel 20 years in the days of the Philistine." Now, imagine if you have 20 years going by. One verse represents 20 years. I want you to understand that. One verse represents 20 years. It's kind of hard for us to imagine those 20 years, but could you imagine 20 years of his unbelievable strength? Everybody else being in awe of him, hearing the stories. Man, did you hear about Samson? He killed 1,000 people with the jawbone of a donkey. And if you missed last week, I encourage you to go back online and watch last week, because it's one of my very favorites of all time. It was cool. Jawbone of a donkey. And going around and hearing about this. Could you imagine Samson walking in and everybody going, oh, there he is. There he is. See, who's somebody in your life that you would be in awe of if they were to walk through here today? Would it be Michael Jordan? Would it be somebody, a current basketball player, LeBron James? Would it be a NASCAR driver, Dale Jr.? Who was it that could grace your presence? You'd be like, wow, that is awesome. There they are. There they are. They're so-and-so. Who would that be? Right now, we're winding up with golf season right here. I mean, would it be Tiger Woods? He's like very famous through here. Who is that would grab your attention? Could you imagine 20 years of that, of everywhere Samson went, having all this attention? Oh, and nobody messed with him because of his unbelievable strength. Nobody messed with him because of his very presence of God, and they knew that God was with this man. So 20 years of this. Because you imagine 20 years of this, would you become complacent? Almost get a point to where you think probably very highly of yourself because everybody was in awe. You go to the restaurant, oh, Mr. Samson, here, take my table. Take my food. You want my kids? Take them. Take them. I'm here. You want some more tea? I don't even work here, but I'll go get you some tea. Could you imagine that kind of awe? I mean, just think about your favorite celebrity sitting right beside of you. What would you do for them? Justin Timberlake walks through here. What do we do? Oh, Miss Emily. Woo. I'm not getting into all that. Well, there's a danger here, and we don't see the danger that Samson has until you turn over to the next chapter. Look at Judges, the very next chapter. This is Judges 16, verse 1. Look at this. Samson went to Gaza, where he saw a prostitute, and he went to bed with her. Now notice in this point, and in those 20 years, we don't hear any word from God, no action from God, but we see an action from Samson. He saw a prostitute, and he went to bed with her. He saw something, and he acted. He wanted something, and he got it. Now wait a minute, I thought Samson was full of God here now. He had the presence of God on his life. Look at the extraordinary strength that he had. But yet he sees something, and he acted on it. Now what's amazing about this is that we don't see any type of repercussion. We don't see God come down and say, Samson, you laid with a prostitute. You're now doomed to hell. We don't see any of that. We don't see about any of the presence of God leaving him. We see Samson seeing something and acting. So let me ask you this. Does sin have a consequence to us? Does it have a consequence to us? Now, I want you to be very careful before you answer. Very careful before you answer. Because I think sometimes we play tricks on ourselves, sometimes it's Satan, that tells us that, hey, nobody's looking around. Nobody's going to know. Oh, it's just one pill. Oh, it's just one flirty conversation. It's harmless. It's just a few minutes on the internet. Nobody's going to know. Does it affect you? Again, I should be very cautious before you answer. Very cautious. Samson saw something, and he reacted. Now, look at this next part. We don't see any repercussion. We don't see God say anything. God does not speak to anything of his behavior. But I want you to look at verse 2. When the Gazites heard that Samson was there, they surrounded the place and waited in ambush for him all that night at the city gate. While they were waiting quietly, they said, let us wait until dawn, and then we will kill him. But verse 3, but Samson stayed in bed until midnight, and when he got up, took hold of the doors of the city gate along with the two gateposts and pulled them out, bar and all. He put them on his shoulders, and he took them to the top of the mountain overlooking Hebron. Now this is amazing. They waited in ambush at the city gate. They were like, hey, let's go to the city gate. Let's wait until morning. We're going to attack him. Specifically, we're going to kill him. But instead, nobody told Samson the plan, but he circumvented it, stayed at the prostitute's place until midnight, got up, left, They were at the city gate waiting, but he just took the gates off of the city, the doorpost, the bar, took the whole thing, carried it up on top of the mountain, showboating. Samson was a bully. Showboating. Look what I did. Look what I did. Nothing could touch Samson. Nobody could touch him. Here in an ambush, we don't have no idea how many men, but many men gathered around here. And he's like, "Oh, that's nothing. I'll just take your gates off. You won't let me pass? I'll just take your gates off." So he took the gates off. And this also had repercussion on the people, because now their city is exposed to the elements. It's exposed to attacks because Samson ripped the gates and the doorpost off. And he took them up the hill. And what's amazing about this, the Spirit of God didn't enter him. God never said a word. He just got done laying with the prostitute, but he still had his strength. God never said anything. God never said a single word about this. And the story continues. Look at verse 4. Sometime later, he fell in love with a woman named Delilah, who lived in the Sorek Valley. The Philistine leaders went to her and said, "Persuade him to tell you where his great strength comes from, so we can overpower him, tie him up, and make him helpless." I want you all to say that word, helpless, "and make him helpless." Let's say it again, but this time I really want you to get it. "And make him helpless. Each of us will then give you 1,100 pieces of silver." Make him helpless. And he's going to use a woman to do it. He loved this woman. Doesn't say that he married her, but he loved her. Doesn't say she was a prostitute, but he loved this woman. And this story is very similar to what we heard just a few weeks ago about his first wife, when the Philistines convinced her, manipulated her, to try to get Samson to reveal his secret of his great strength. And here, they're offering her 1,100 pieces of silver. In today's value, that'd be roughly $8,000 per person. $8,000 per person. Now, what would you do for $8,000? What would you do for $8,000? Now, there's been many TV shows and reality shows on TV about people that would do these certain things. Eat a roach. Would you eat a roach for $8,000? Now, some people are shaking your head no, but I see some going, I think I would. Would you pet a snake? Some people are going, "Lord, no, I heard that." Others? Okay, I'll do it. $8,000? Yeah, I'd do it. I would do it. I would not do it. No snakes or spiders. None. But the key here is they wanted him helpless. Now, she had this dollar sign in front of her. I mean, you had these several men of this organized group willing to give you $8,000 to turn over this man who loves you. Well, money talks. Money talks. They didn't just want to overpower him. They wanted him helpless. They wanted to destroy Samson. So look at verse 6. So Delilah said to Samson, "Please tell me, where does your great strength come from? How could someone tie you up and make you helpless?" Samson told her, "If they tie me up with 7 fresh bowstrings that have not been dried, I will become weak like any other man." Now notice here that he doesn't tell her, "No, I'm not going to tell you." He doesn't tell her, "Hey, you can aggravate me all you want to. I'm not going to tell you." He does not stand his ground. Now here's a man of great strength that can't be a man and stand his ground. Instead, he takes care of himself. Now, this is often the trap that we fall in, and we try to fix things ourselves instead of standing on the rock of Jesus. We try to fix it ourselves. And whenever we try to fix things ourselves, we usually end up what? Making a bigger mess. What happens to Samson? He makes a bigger mess. He says, all you got to do is tie me up with 7 fresh bowstrings. That's all you got to do. You do that. Look at what he says. "And I'll become weak like any other man." Liar. Here's a man that's standing up for God, and he is a liar. A liar. Now, before we ridicule Samson, if truth be told, could we relate a lot to the story of Samson? Again, be very careful how you answer and before you answer. Would we be caught out? So here's what she does. So verse 8. The Philistine leaders brought her 7 fresh bowstrings that had not been dried, and she tied him up with them while the men in ambush are waiting in her room. Now they're waiting in her room. She called out to him, "Samson, the Philistines are here." But he snapped the bowstrings as a strand of yarn snaps when it touches fire. The secret of his strength remained unknown. Now you have this woman that you love. Let's say you have the man of your dreams you love, and they deceive you. They deceive you. What would you do at that moment? Would you give them the boot? Would you give them the talk that says, "Listen, I'm too good for you"? Samson, in all his strength, is blinded by Delilah. He's blinded. Instead of standing his ground, he lies to her and says, "Yep, it's all you got to do. Tie up 7 fresh bowstrings." He tries to fix it on his own. Now, this doesn't make the situation any better. As a matter of fact, it makes it worse. Look at verse 10. Then Delilah said to Samson, "You have mocked me and told me lies. Won't you please tell me how you can be tied up? Please tell me how you can be tied up." Why does she want to know so bad? She wants to get paid. She wants to get paid. So he told her, "Again, if they tie me up with new ropes that have never been used, I'll become weak like any other man." Now, wait a minute. We just read about this last week. This didn't work. They tied him up with 2 brand new ropes that had never been used, and it just fell off. He's lying again. So he didn't lie to Delilah once. Now he's lied to her twice. Twice. And what kind of relationship do you think it is that they have? Is it plainly just physical? We don't know. But look at verse 12. Delilah took the new ropes, tied him up with them, and shouted, "Samson, the Philistines are here." But while the men in ambush are waiting in her room, he snaps the rope off his arms like a thread. Wow. These ropes, it did nothing. But we're seeing into this personal identification of these two people, Samson and Delilah. Samson, in his great strength, has no backbone. Delilah is blinded by greed to manipulate and deceive the person she loves, because she loves money more than him. And still yet, he falls for it again. Have you ever seen anybody like this in your life? Maybe a friend or somebody. You're like, "Man, when are you going to learn? When are you going?" Samson does not learn. Look at verse 13. Then Delilah said to Samson, "You have mocked me all along and told me lies." She's calling him out now. "You liar." But guess what he does? She says, "Tell me how you can be tied up." So he told her, "If you weave 7 braids on my head with the web of a loom, if you do this, verse 14, she fastened the braids with the pin and called to him, "Samson, the Philistines are here." He awoke from his sleep and pulled out the pin with the loom and the web. And church, this time, it's a little different. Now all this time, he's lying to her. He's not told her the truth. But this time, it's a little different. See, we learned back in chapter 14 of Judges that he's under what's called the Nazirite vow. Never to cut his head, not supposed to touch dead animals, dead anything. Not to drink any alcohol. He has a very rigid lifestyle. One of those is his hair is never to be cut. And so this is the first indication he's ever gave that anything has to do with his hair. "Oh, if you'll just weave 7 braids on my head with the web of a loom. If you do that," immediately she does it. And all he does is take the pin out. Of course, his hair fell, and he had his strength. But it's the first time indicating something with his head, his hair. Church, this is what sin does to us. I've heard my father-in-law preach this many times, that sin will take you further than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. Sin. Just a few minutes ago, you heard Dad talk and allude to all the effects of sin and what it does to us. But I think the danger is when it's all over us and we have no idea it's there. I've asked a volunteer to come up here and help me up. So Alex. This is David Smith, our youth pastor. This is his son. Will y'all show him some love as he comes up here to the stage? This is Alex. And he said he would help me out here because I've got something cool that I want to do with Alex here. I'm pretty excited. And so this is Alex Smith. And if you haven't met Alex, all you have to do is look at David Smith and you'll see that it's a spitting image of Alex here. Now the thing about Alex is Alex suffers from the same problem that I have. The exact same problem. You see your dad back there? You see him right there? You know what the downfall is? You look just like him. just a matter of fact, I had somebody tell me yesterday, we were eating at Teddy's. Is anybody, if you ever ate at Teddy's, we love Teddy's. Teddy's is great food, and we were there, and there's this lady, she said, "Oh, I know you, you're Jules' son." I am. She's like, "Wow, you look just like your dad." I went, "I know. My dad's 74. I'm way younger than that, but thank you. Thank you." And we just favor, but that's not a downfall. I mean, your dad is okay. I'm not going to say he's good looking, but he's okay. Now, Alex has volunteered to come up here with me, and what Alex represents here today, Alex represents you. Okay, going through life, he represents you. And that's what I've got. I've got these, you see this, I've got this pole right here. Now, this pole right here, what I want you to do is, I want you to grab that pole, and I want you to set it up right up here, okay? Just grab the pole, I just want you to set it right up here. It's somewhat heavy. Just set it right there. Oh, man, good job. That's great. Great. Now, was that heavy? Kind of heavy. So what this is, it has this barrier. So it's a barrier pole. It's got a big, strong base right here. All right, so I've got another one over here. So if you don't care, I want you to grab it, if you don't care. And I want you to set it up right over here. Now then, oh, man, good job. All right, so here's what I want you to do now. I know this is going to be a little bit harder, but can you carry both of them at the same time? And what I want you to do is I want you to take both of them at the same time to carry them back over here where you did this first one. Let me get your way. Carry it back over here. There you go. Good job, buddy. Good job. Now set it down right here. There you go. That's fine. Good job. All right, everybody give Alex a hand here. It's great. Now, here's the downfall, okay? And here's what sin will do to us. We're going through life doing all that we're doing, but sin is taking us for a ride. We don't even know it's there. Alex, you feel anything on your back? But yet he has a kick me sign. And another kick me sign. And another kick me sign. And this one says, "I'm a weenie." Thanks, Alex. Y'all show him some love. This is Alex Smith. Thanks, buddy, for helping us. I'm going to ask you this question. This is very personal. What's on your back? What sign is on your back? You don't even know it's there. Church, this is what sin will do to us. Satan's there and tells us, "Oh, good job," but he's putting kick me signs. We're wondering why we're having such a hard time. I think we're giving the devil opportunity to just hop on our back. Sin will take you further than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. Now remember, he's flirting here with this idea. "Oh, my hair, just put 7 braids in it and tied up with this loom. Yeah, I'll lose my strength." Look what happens next. And this is dangerous. Samson has been going through this. He's telling her this story. And now we have this idea of what's happening to Samson. He's tying her up here. He has this idea, or she has this. Now she has a hold of him. Look at what she does. She says, so she fastened the braids to him with a pin. He called him Samson, and then put up in his sleep. He just pulled out the pin. Now look at this next verse. "How can you say I love you?" Now people will try to manipulate us all day long. They'll try to manipulate us, call us names, and try to force us to get on their side. Now that's what she's doing. How can you say this? She said, "When your heart is not with me." Now is this not a lover's quarrel, what we say? This is very dangerous. She says, "This is the third time you have mocked me and not told me what makes your strength so great." And she's calling him out. "Not only are you a liar, but you do not love me." And church, if anybody, and I'm just going to go, this has nothing to do with the message, but I just want you to understand this. God, I tell this to my kids all the time. If someone tries to manipulate you with the word love, they do not love you. Period. Love is not manipulation. It's not. I spoke my piece. Next verse. Look what he says here. She said, "Because you nagged him," or "because she nagged him day after day and pleaded with him until she wore him out, he told her the whole truth and said to her, 'My hair has never been cut, because I'm a Nazarite to God from birth. If I'm shaved, my strength will leave me, and I'll become weak and be like any other man." Oh, man, she told him the whole truth. The whole truth. Do you think this has some repercussion? Look at this next part. This next part. Verse 18, "When Delilah realized that he had told her the whole truth, she sent message to the Philistine leaders, 'Come one more time, for he has told me the whole truth.' The Philistine leaders came to her and brought the money with them." Why? Oh, she's got it now. She's got him. Hook, line, and sinker, as the expression goes. She's got him. "Bring me your money, boys. I got it. I got it." If someone manipulates you, they do not love you. What does she love? The Philistine leaders came to her and brought her the money. This time it's different. See, all this other time, Samson has been able to go around with sin and still have his strength, but he didn't know that he had all these signs all over his back. He didn't even feel it. He didn't feel the sin on him, but it was there. And the grace of God is all through the Old Testament, not just the New Testament. And the grace of God was with Samson up to this point. And it reached a point that you'll see. Verse 19. "Then she let him fall asleep on her lap and called a man to shave off the 7 braids on his head. In this way, she made him," what's the word? "She made him helpless. And his strength left him. Then she cried, 'Samson, the Philistines are here.' When he awoke from his sleep, he said, 'I will escape as I did before and shake myself free.' But he did not know that the Lord had left him." The most heartbreaking sentence of this entire passage. He didn't know that it had left him. He didn't know that the Lord had left him. He didn't know that all these sin tags had been all over him. And the presence of God was gone. And he didn't even realize it. Here's a man who had this unbelievable strength. Had this extraordinary ability to demonstrate the power of God. And he didn't even know that he had left him. He said, "Oh, I'll just do what I did every time before. It's okay." In church, we do the same thing in our life. We'll get caught doing something and we'll lie our way out of it. "Oh, I'll just do what I did before. I'll just lie. It ain't hurting nobody. I'll just lie my way out of it. I'll just lie my way out of it." This is what Samson did. Lying his way out of it. And he's caught up in a web of lies and in sin. Corrupted him. And he never knew it. And he finally trusted the one person he should have never trusted, because she didn't show any sign of love towards him. From the very beginning, all she was trying to do was manipulate him into telling his very secret. But if she really cared for Samson, she would have known his Nazarite vow. She would have known the secret to his strength. The danger is that Samson didn't even know that the presence of the Lord had left him. Didn't even know it. Samson had become complacent. His strength, it meant nothing anymore. It meant nothing. We sometimes look at people in awe, but to them, they just get so used to it. So used to it. And it just becomes, So I remember going through school, and my dad had these unbelievable forearms, and he still does, unbelievable forearms. And so all the boys at vocational school, they wanted to arm wrestle Dad. They were arm wrestling somebody who was a whole lot older than he was, and he was just... And he would ag it on. Here they was sweating. I'm thinking blood vessels going to pop. They're red, and Dad's here, "You ready to start yet?" And that's what he was doing. That's what he's doing. But then, day after day, they finally just gave up. Nah, we don't want none. It's no big deal. We can get so used to it that it means nothing anymore. Means nothing anymore. Same thing with your marriage. You can get so accustomed, just same routine, just falling to the right, to the same routine, that it means nothing anymore. It means nothing anymore. With strength, we can do the same thing with strength and be so in awe of it. But once you see it so many times, it's no big deal anymore. Church, this is where Hollywood and television really struggle to try to change things up so we don't get complacent watching TV. Saying the same, I've seen everything before. This is why they have all these twists and turns and these new ideas. And this, in the past 15 years, reality TV has just completely and totally changed because nobody had seen it before. See, I remember in the 80s, the controversy over the A-Team. Do you remember the A-Team? B.A. Baracus? Petey the Fool? Didn't want to drive on a plane or fly on a plane. He just, in Crazy Murdoch, just, I need some trash bike. I mean, the A-Team was awesome, okay? But there was a big controversy over the A-Team because of the violence. But there was never a single drop of blood. But yet it was controversy. Now we look at television now and we see nothing but violence and death and blood. See how it's changed? And what do? We can be complacent. We get so accustomed to it, so used to it. It doesn't mean anything to us anymore. I was talking to another preacher the other day and we was talking about these movies that's out. And I just tell my kids, hey, this is fantasy, it's movies, it's not real. We don't use this language. But yet, we're just consuming it and consuming it and consuming it and consuming it. Just consuming it. We can get so complacent. Where's the wow factor? We have given it away. To the point to where it doesn't mean anything anymore. And what caused Samson was his presence of God. And he was so accustomed to the sin that he didn't even know the Spirit of God had left him. Church, I want to ask you, the Spirit of God, is it with you? Is it with you? Is it with you? Do you know it's with you? Or do you have this situation in life that you didn't know that the Lord had even left you? See, there's two parts to this, I think. One is the presence of God. Is it with you right now? Is it with you? Or maybe you're struggling with the things that's getting on your back. The things that you've allowed in. Maybe to take control. Maybe to take some time. The things that we allow our focus, our attention to. My father-in-law says it all the time. Sin will take you further than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. Right now, what's got a hold on you? Is it the power of God? Is it the power of God? Or have you found yourself into a complacency routine? Just so used to going to church, you're just leaving. Coming to church and leaving. Hey, what are you doing Sunday? I'm going to church. And then that's it. Church, it's more than just about going to church. It's a lifestyle relationship we have with our Heavenly Father. And Jesus is at the center of it. And along with it, we have some other Christians together. And this is what the whole point of it is that we would come together and worship God, then work on our relationship with Him and work on our relationship with other people. As a matter of fact, a few weeks ago, we had some time that we had a time of fellowship here. Remember, we played Alan Jackson, I'll Fly Away, and we went around and we shook hands and we said, hey, good morning to you. And we said all this because we need each other. We need relationships. What do you think would have happened if somebody's up here with Alex? Every time a kick me sign got on his back going, hey, you got a kick me sign. Do you ever remember these in high school? I got the far kicked out of me one time because of this, and it took me a long time to figure it out. But I had a friend that says, hey, man, you're getting your butt kicked because you got a kick me sign on your back. I think everybody needs a good friend that'll tell them the truth. Did that hurt my feelings? Yeah, it did. Did my buddy move it? Yeah, he did. He took it off. Church, this is why relationships in church is so important. There are people to go along through life with us and say, hey man, got some kick me signs in your back. You're flirting around with the wrong thing here. You're messing around with sin here. You're going down a dark road. You need to be careful. I wouldn't be posting that on social media. I'd be careful with that person, all right? You want to be careful with that person. Remember, you got a husband at home. Hey, your kids, they're looking up to you. Somebody in your corner that would guide you. Could you imagine how this would have been different for Samson if somebody had been there in his corner and said, hey, man, I think you're headed down a dark path. But who would Samson have to listen to? He was stronger than anybody. Everybody was in awe of him, and he became complacent and then allowed an opportunity for a sin to come in. Church, my question to you is two things. One, what's on your back? And is the presence of the Lord with you today? What's on your back? And is the presence of the Lord with you today? Now, right here through this, and we're not seeing the end story. This right here is what led to his fall. And next week we're learning about what happens next. But I don't think anybody just falls from their relationship with God. I don't think anybody falls out of their marriage, or anybody falls from their love for their job, or falls from the love for the family just overnight in one day. I believe it's a slow fade. Slow fade that we allow. Just like Samson, one thing creep in. Oh, I'm okay. I didn't hurt nobody. I'm good. Me and God, we're good. But then that can lead to another kick me sign. That can lead to another kick me sign. And the next thing we know, we've got a mess. It's the same thing with kids. It's the same thing with you and your rooms. It doesn't just become a mess just overnight. It's a slow process. For some of you, it's a little bit faster process. But it's a slow process. Here's a little bit of trash over there. It's okay. But then some clothes here, some toys here, some shoes here. The next thing you know, you've got a mess that takes you 3 hours to clean up. Slow fade. Here's what I'm asking you today is two things. What's on your back? And are you still filled with the presence of God? I have no idea what you've got going on in your life, and it's really irrelevant to this point. It's really irrelevant. But what's on your back is what we allow to come in. But the presence of God is what will stand against sin. We'll have a presence to ward us off. That says, hey, you've got some stuff on your back. Is it what the Holy Spirit does to us in our life? Man, when I mess up, I don't have to have my wife to tell me sometimes. She does. But I don't have to have that, because usually God said, hey, man, you messed up big time. Sometimes I don't even see it. And sometimes I'm like, oh, God, you're wrong. I'm okay. And then my six-year-old will come up to me and go, hey, Dad, I think you got this wrong. The six-year-old calling me out. It happens. Church, what's on your back? What's on your back? What have you allowed to come into your life that ought not be there? And it's harming your relationship with God. And the other goes along with it. Are you filled with the presence of God? See, I'm not asking if you're saved or lost this morning. Are you filled with the presence of God? The most dangerous part of this entire verse. When he got up, look at this. When he got up, he said, I will escape as I did before. I'll just do what I did before. And we'll do the same thing. I'll just do what I did before. I'll lie. I'll cheat. I'll steal if I have to. I'll do whatever I got to do to get out of the situation. And it says, and shake myself free. Whatever I got to do. But he did not know that the Lord had left him. Church, is the Lord with you today? Is the presence of the Lord with you today? If he is, then I encourage you to pray for strength to endure the hardships that we face tonight, because we're going to face hardships. We have an adversary, the devil, and he's roaring, trying to tire us down. But we're stronger than that. Not because of who we are, but who we represent. Who we're filled with. Jesus. And I believe there's things that we can overcome. Doesn't mean it's not going to be without challenges. It's going to be very difficult. If you're living and breathing today, life is going to be difficult. It'll be difficult. There's going to be times you're going to wonder, God, where are you at? But I assure you, he's right there. Ready for you to lean on him. Ready for you to come to him. Maybe you're here today and you don't even know that the presence of the Lord has left you. Or maybe you do know. You're nowhere near close to God as what you used to be. Church, it's time to pray. Get these things off our backs. And let's return to the joy that we have in Jesus. Would you take a moment? Would you pray with me right now? Father God, we love you and thank you for your word. And here we are reading about Samson. And it happened so long ago, but it's still relevant to us here today. And God, you're not done yet. You're not done with the story. You're not done with us. God, in so many times in our life, we can fall victim to sin. It's temptation. God, we can fall so victim to this world, and we can become so stained with that we don't even realize it's on us. Just as Alex didn't realize those kick me signs were on him. I pray right now, Father, that you'd reveal yourself unto us, that we may know where we stand with you. Whether your presence is with us or whether it's not. Whether we have things that's on us, on our backs, or not. Reveal yourself, Father, to us right now. As you continue to pray, there's some of you here today, you've got things that are weighting you down, things that's on your back right now, and you know it. It's affecting your relationship with God. It's affecting your relationship with people. It's affecting you at work. It's affecting your finances. It's affecting all areas of your life. There's things that's weighted on your back that's got you weighted down. Whether it's sin, whether it's relationships, whether it's flirtatious, no matter what it is. Things you do in private or publicly, but things that have weighted you down. Church, I'm telling you, it's time to cast those things aside and give those to God. That we may stand strong and bold and filled with His Holy Spirit. Church, if that's you right now, you've got things that's weighted you down right now, would you give those to God? Would you lay those down at His feet? Whatever it is that's weighted you down, give it over to Him right now. Church, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand or call you out. I'm just saying, lay it down at His feet. Whatever it is that's weighted you down, the things that's on your back, would you give it to Him right now? Give it to Him right now. Give it to Him, whatever it is. It may be your relationship with Him that's affected. It may be your relationship with other people, or your spouse, or your kids, or your in-laws, or your parents, your siblings. Those may be the effects of it, but the root of it is the sin you've got on your back, the things you've allowed on your back. Right now, church, I'm telling you to confess those to God, and let's get those off. Get those off. Father, we've got people praying to you right now, and I pray, God, you give them the strength to get this stuff off their back. As they're making confessions to you, Father, I pray that you would reveal yourself unto them. Let them know that you're there, and they can cast these burdens down at your feet. As you continue to pray, there's others of you here today that your relationship with God is not where you want it to be. Maybe it's not where it used to be. Maybe it's not where it's meant to be. That the presence of God has said He didn't know that it left Him, but you know that your presence of God is not where it needs to be in your life. Church, it's time to do something about that. It's time to do something about that. I think the first step to that is to admit that that's where we're at. That you and God, you're not on the same page. That this relationship with God has been affected. Whether it's by sin or relationships or outside sources, we're not where we need to be with God. Church, if that's you today right now, call out to God right now and say, God, my relationship with you is not where it needs to be. It's not where it needs to be. I need you, God, in my life. I need you to be number one. Help me to make the steps to make it number one. I need you in my life. To be real, to be relevant, to be true. I need you in my life. Help me, God. Give you my very best and hold nothing back. My very best and hold nothing back. As you continue to pray, I want to ask you now. We talked about two things, the things that may be on our backs and our relationship with God and where we stand with Him. Now I want you to keep your eyes closed just for a moment. I want you to imagine me, if you will, a church that's all out for God. A family that's all out for God. Sold out. Imagine your workplace all out for God. Could you imagine it? Can you imagine? And what if you're the key? What if you're the key for changing your home environment? What if you're the key for changing your work environment? What if you're the key for changing your school? What if you're the key for changing the life of someone around you? What if you're the key? Church, we can't be the key when we're weighted down, but filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and the presence of God. We can do anything. We'll be that city set on a hill. How can we have this life? How can we have this relationship fulfilled? Well, we can be so filled with the presence of God. Church, it's living for Him. Living for Him. And I challenge you today that you walk out of these doors different. With an idea, reality, that we're going to walk out different than we came in. We're not just going to become complacent like what we have become. But we're going to read our Bibles expecting to get something out of it. We're going to be a light at work. We're going to be a light at home. Well, God, we're going to be a light for you even when it's difficult. And Father, I pray that you'd fill us up so much with the presence of your Holy Spirit that it just radiates out and we will truly be that city set on a hill that cannot be hid. That others can look to and they can look past us. They can look past our faults and even our failures because they are seeing Jesus. That is the name that we uplift today, Father. And I pray that as we go throughout this week, as we live our life, our conversations, our work ethic, our home life would reflect our relationship with Jesus. Father, I pray that you go with us now and help us, God, that we'd be that city set on a hill, that we'd be a great big light for you, and that as people look to us, they're going to see Jesus. Father, I pray for every family that's here. Every family. I pray, Father, that your presence would grace it, and that they would live for you. God, I know that there's some families here today that they may be struggling, or they may be having to deal with some family issues or quarrels. God, I pray that you would strengthen them and help them, Father, to put you at the center of it. Father, I pray for every marriage here, Father, that you would strengthen them and bind them and help. God, I pray that you'd help them to be aligned unto one another. Restore, Father, that which is broken. Mend, Father, that which can be touched. And lead, Father, those in leadership in these families, they can be alive. God, I pray for all of our kids as they go to school. I know that it's tough. I know that sometimes we have outside forces that are trying to manipulate us or try to get us to do things. But as we're reminded with Samson and Delilah, they do not love us. Manipulation is not love. But you are love, Father. In the powerful name of Jesus, Father, we pray that we would go out into the world today and that we would show that love, that we'd be true to our word, we'd be true to your word, and God, that we would be a light for all to see. And may we be that example. I pray, God, now for strength for the journey, that you'd lead us and guide us as we go throughout this week, and that all we say and all we do would bring glory and honor to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you take a moment and give God some awesome praise? God, I love you so, so very much.